I'd like to welcome all you calculus enthusiasts here to an integration techniques kind of extra lecture, I guess you could call it. This is just kind of some strategies whenever we're looking at integrating. It could be a definite integral. We're going to look at indefinite cases here. But basically, what is our approach going to be when we sit down and try to break this apart? Because we've learned a lot of different techniques, and what's going to be the best one for each case? So let's take a look. All right, so first, whenever we're dealing with integration, we want to remember that the fundamental theorem of calculus is telling us that integrating undoes derivation. So all those derivative rules that we learned earlier in the year to derivate a function, if we backtrack our way through those rules, we are integrating. And that's what the fundamental theorem is saying. And that's just some very casual paraphrasing on my part. There are a lot more nuances to that. But if we take away this idea that integrating undoes derivation, then we're going to be in really, really good shape, at least to lay a foundation. Right, so when we first look at an integral, the first question we want to be asking ourselves is, can we simply undo a derivative rule? Can we work backwards through a basic derivative rule and arrive at an answer? Another thing I'm going to point out right here is that whenever we do find an integral, we can always check by derivating and see if it gets us back to the function inside. If they truly do undo one another, derivation and integration, then we should be able to check every answer we come up with pretty quickly. All right, so here we go. The first one, you can see this is a pretty simple integral to carry out, the integral of sine x dx. Well, if I'm working my way back through that one, what function produces a derivative of sine x? Well, it's cosine x, but cosine x turns into negative sine x. So I need a negative sign out front to hold place. And then, because there could have been a constant that disappeared when I derivated, I need to make a place for that with a arbitrary plus c at the end to represent that a constant could be present there as well. And of course, this means we need to know our derivative rules pretty thoroughly. The next one, secant x tangent x. Well, if I were to derivate a secant function, that would lead me directly to secant x tangent x. So to undo that derivation, I'm just heading back to secant. And then again, we have the possibility that there was a constant that derivated away to zero. So we got to mark that place with a plus c as well. The next one, 1 over x. Now, this one is tempting to call that x to the negative first power and try and backwards engineer a power rule. However, since this is simply 1 over x, the derivative of natural log x leads me to 1 over x. And we need a placeholder there, plus c. Now, I will just extend my thought here on this one. Because if I were to do the integral of 1 over x squared, then I would want to go backwards through a power rule. It's only when it's 1 over something to a first power that we want to consider natural log. Otherwise, it is a power rule at work. Okay, and lastly, well, this one is a little bit of an offshoot. There's a little bit more of an adjustment to make. I kind of see hidden within there an e to the, and I know that the derivative of e to the is itself, so I know there's an e to the something in there. However, if I start off with e to the 2x, and I derivate that, I will get 2e to the 2x because there's a chain rule happening. So when I antiderivate this e to the 2x to pull it out of that integral, to undo the integral, or to evaluate the integral, I should say, we're not trying to undo it, I need to have a placeholder of 1 half. And that negative sign, that has to stay in place as well. And we need our placeholder plus c. So we may need to introduce a constant if we have something like, maybe our sine function in the first example was sine of 3x. There's going to be a chain rule that applies when we derivate, so we need to be ready to undo that chain rule as well as the derivative work. Okay, but other than that, this is our most basic. We hope that we see a lot of integrals like this because it's very easy to handle those. And if we are ever in doubt that we did our work correctly or not, that we apply the correct derivative rule, just try derivating what you came up with to get back to the integrand and see if you arrive at the same thing. Secondly, Well, what if there's a more complicated chain rule? It's not just a constant like that last example we went through. Is there a chain rule in our integral? So that's the next question we're asking ourselves. When we think chain rule, we think we derivate the function, so we have some function. I shouldn't write this. So if I were to derivate a composition of functions, f of g of x, and I'm going to derivate that, it would be the outside derivative of the inside thing times the derivative of the thing inside. So I'm looking for this type of relationship to work my way backwards out of. Is that showing up in my integral? Do I have a function and that function has something inside and the derivative of that inside thing is present as well? So that's what we're trying to backwards engineer here with U substitution. So I'm just going to kind of look over the integral in its entirety, and usually you'll see this with trig functions, sometimes with exponential functions or radicals or things like that as well. But I notice hidden within this first example that I've got some function of sine, and then I've got the derivative of sine present. So here's how I denote what's happening. We're going to let some function u represent, in this case, this whole quantity. The sine squared of x. No, sorry. We're going to let this represent just sine of x. Then I know that the derivative of function u will just be cosine of x dx. Well, you can see that now my integral becomes that function u. That's the sine of x squared plus 1. And then cosine of x dx, that is du. So now I've created a function that represents the outside thing. In this case, what's happening to my sine of x, the function inside? Well, it's being squared and I have 1 added to it. Plus, I also have the differential in place that goes right along with that outside function, du. All those pieces were in place. And to anti-differentiate this, now I'm just going backwards through the power rule. It's u to the third and one third that quantity. That way, if I derivate, I'll get back to u squared plus u, that constant of one, anti-derivates to u. And then I got rid of the integral, so I better put that plus c. That constant could be present as well. All that's left to do is substitute our sine of x back in for u, right? We started off with a function of x. We had better end with one. And we have our integral. Again, this is a nice, easy derivation back to see if we arrive back at what we started with to make sure that we had done our correct work in evaluating the integral. Now, there are some, like this next example, where, sneak the recording box out of the way, where there's a little bit more involved. Here, you can see that I've got like an inside thing, right? X squared plus 3. And the derivative of that, it isn't 5x. So there's some different arrangements that we could need to be considering here. There's a property of integrals that says I'm allowed to free any constant multiple out of the integrand. So here, this 5 is a constant multiplied into the integrand. I can free that. This is an equivalent integral. Okay. Now I can see that, oh man, this thing inside, this x squared minus 3, well, what's the derivative of the thing inside? It's 2x. I only have an x. We are allowed to adjust, again, just constant multiples. We're allowed to adjust the integral to handle this. We can't do it with variables, but we can do it with constants. So if I multiply in the 2 that is needed for my dx, I just need to multiply a 1 half outside the integral so that in effect, I'm really multiplying it by 1. It's kind of a sneaky little trick, and it's neat how it maintains balance within the integral. So now I've got 5 over 2 integral 2x of the square root of quantity x squared minus 3 dx. Now, if I let u equal that inside thing, x squared plus 3 du will equal 2x dx. And hey, I've got a 2x and dx multiplied into that integral. I'm really dealing with that 5 halves stays out front, but the square root of u du. And now I can antiderivate. Square root of u is very easy to work with. I've handled the inside function with a u substitution, so now I can just work with, what's that outside function, that outermost one in our chain rule. All right, so 5 halves stays out front, and then to antiderivate square root of u, it will be 2/3 times u to the 3 halves power, just moving backwards through a power rule, and then plus c. We've got some simplifying that can take place. All this is being multiplied together in our u term. So I end up with 5/3, and then u to the 3 halves would be the square root of, what was u again? X squared minus 3. And that's being raised to the third power, square root third power. That's what makes the 3 halves exponent. And of course, our plus c, always there to denote any constant that may have derivated away to 0. And again, I could confirm this answer, be really confident in this answer, if I check it by derivating. Do I get back to that integral or that integrand that I started with? All right, so there's u substitution. That's what we want to look for. Secondly, is there like a chain rule that's taking place, a function and its derivative kind of coexisting inside the integral? And it looks like I forgot to change the examples for this. I'll be back in a flash with new examples. That looks a little bit better. Sorry about the negligence on my part. That's kind of embarrassing. So the next method that we're going to look for, say we don't find a direct antiderivative and we can't get a u substitution to fit, we don't recognize that pattern showing up, then we want to look for integration by parts. And parts, instead of having that nice outside derivative of the inside thing times the derivative of the thing inside, so we don't have that derivative of the thing inside present, what if it's just an arbitrary product of two functions? So like for this example, I've got 2x times the cosine of x. Well, the derivative of cosine is going to be, in no way related to that 2x out front. There's no derivative relationship there, so I can't use a u substitution here. The method we use is called parts, and this is a way to undo the product rule. And the rule for integration by parts is that I'm going to look at what I start with as two separate functions. So I'm trying to find the integral of this 2x cosine x dx. I'm just going to call that u times dv. Okay, so one part is going to be the differential of a function v. The other part will be its own function u. And the rule states, this rule is found by integrating both sides of our product rule and rearranging some terms, but we get u times v, there's the product, minus the integral of v du. So we're basically taking this 2x and the cosine x, and we're splitting it up into two functions, u and v, that are being multiplied together. But we're doing so in a very careful way. Now you'll notice that there are some pieces of this integral that we have and some that we do not. So in other words, if I break this down to u and I call all of this dv, I do not have regular v and I do not have du. So the way I like to keep this organized is to make a little box. I know it may seem a little childish, but I have u, that is my 2x, and I have dv, that's the remainder of my integrand, cosine x dx. What I don't have is du or v. So I need to fill in those portions. I need all four of those boxes filled in before I can use my integration by parts. Well, du is pretty easy. It's just taking the derivative of function u. Well, derivative of 2x is just 2 times the derivative of the thing inside. So, 2 dx. And function v, here to go from dv to v, I need to anti-differentiate. And what would derivate to that cosine? Well, it would be a sine x. So now I'm going to set up my integral. Let's do a slanted equal sign so I can fit everything here. That's going to be u times v minus the integral of v du. And the hopes here is that when we go through this integration by parts formula, we end up with an integral here that is very easy to antiderivate. So it's like the first type of integral, the ones we're hoping for. And we've definitely set that up here. You should be able to tell pretty quickly when you start to set up your box, why did I choose the 2x to be u? Why wouldn't I choose cosine to be that? You should be able to tell pretty quickly. Sometimes it works well both ways, regardless of your selection of what is u, what is dv. But sometimes one way will work and the other, you get no simpler integral at the end of plugging everything into this formula. So you'll be able to tell pretty quickly if you're on the right track or not, which is nice. Okay, so let's clean this up a bit. I've got 2x sine x minus the integral of sine of x times 2 dx. I'm going to free that 2, right? We can free constants that are multiplied in. And now I should be able to arrive at my solution. 2x sine of x minus 2 times what's the antiderivative of sine? Well, that's negative cosine x. And then we got rid of our integral, so time to put that arbitrary constant at the end. Here's our final solution. 2x sine of x plus 2 cosine of x plus c. And again, if we had any doubts, we could check that by derivation. I know I haven't thus far, but I think I will check this one by derivation right now. If I wanted to derivate this function that I just found, the first thing I come across is a product rule. So I would do first d second plus second d first plus that second term, 2 times cosine of x. That's just a regular trig derivative rule. I'm going to subtract away 2 sine of x because the derivative of cosine is negative sine. And then, of course, that plus c derivates to plus 0. And you can see really quickly here, this, if I combine my like terms, I've got plus 2 sine x and minus 2 sine x. I end up with 2x cosine of x. And look at that. That's just what I started with in my inside my integral. I know I've done that problem correctly. Now, this definitely requires a little bit of foresight, kind of like u substitution. We kind of have to pick and choose kind of carefully to see if we're going along the right path and evaluate our process as we go along. But it really is a smooth one. Okay, next, there are some extensions to integration by parts. The first one is what I call the tabular method. If we were to try to integrate this by parts, what we would find is that our integral at the end, well, here, let me write out our rule again. We would find that our integral at the end is no simpler. So we'd have to go through integration by parts again with that integral. And then maybe it doesn't get much simpler then. So we'd have to go through integration by parts with it, that remaining integral yet again. There's an algorithm called the tabular method that helps us out organizing all of this greatly, like very, very, very much. And it's important to realize that this method only works if one of the parts of our integrand will derivate to zero. So in other words, typically, do we have what looks like just a regular power term as one of our parts? In this case, I've got x cubed. If I derivate that enough, I will get to zero. Otherwise, it's not possible, and we'll talk about that in the next slide. How I set this up is I like to think of this integrand as being an f of x, that'll be my x cubed, times some other function g of x. I'll let sine of x represent that. So I've got one of my parts that I know will derivate down to zero. The other one, I have to be able to repeatedly integrate. So with my f of x, here what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off with x cubed, and I'm going to repeatedly derivate this. So this column is derivated repeatedly until I get to that zero that I wanted. So first derivative, second derivative, third derivative, and at the fourth derivative, I arrive at my zero. The second column, that g of x, I'm going to repeatedly integrate that. So I'm anti-differentiating that term. All right, so we start off with a sine of x. Then if I anti-differentiate that, that had to come from a negative cosine of x. Anti-differentiate that, it had to come from a negative sine x. Anti-differentiate that, that had to come from a regular cosine x. Anti-differentiate that, that had to come from a regular sine x. And I want to keep doing this integration, this anti-differentiation, until I have a matching entry for everything that I derivated under my f of x column. And what this nice little algorithm is going to do for us, it's going to take care of repeatedly needing to do this integration for VDU. It's taking care of doing integration by parts over and over and over and over again. The problem is, every time we do this, you know, if I break this down into another one, I could have UV from the first one minus, then if I break this down by parts, let's say this is S and T, I would have ST minus the integral of T ds. And then I would break this down. We keep getting these negatives that distribute, so there are a lot of sign switches involved. And so the final part of our tabular method is going to be, I'm going to connect my first f of x with my second g of x and keep this pattern going. These are going to be products that produce terms, and again, it's kind of tough to visualize right now, but terms that would be emerging if I were to keep integrating by parts. All right, and then I'm just going to show with a plus or minus sign, starting with a plus, this first product, I'm going to keep what sign I get. So I show that with a plus. The next one, whatever product I get, I'm going to negate. I'm going to switch the sign, and then that pattern continues. And again, the reason it keeps switching sign is because of all these negatives that keep distributing if we were to keep using integration by parts at its fullest. So you can see this problem right here, in order to get to my final solution, I would have to do integration by parts three times before I could arrive at my final answer. That's a lot of terms to lay out, a lot of little boxes to make to fill in with your U's and your DV's. This makes short work of it. So we're ready to come up with our answer, if you can believe that. The first part of my integral is going to be made by x cubed times negative cosine x, and I'm not changing the sign of that product. Negative x cubed cosine x. The next term I am going to negate. It's 3x squared times negative sine x, so that'll be a negative product, and I'm going to negate that, so it'll be a positive 3x squared sine x. The next product will be a positive 6x cosine x, and the final term will be a negative 6 sine x. So all written out, and I'm going to write this out so I can derivate it and confirm that it works. Maybe it's going to be a nasty product rule. We'll see. So I got negative x cubed cosine x plus 3x squared sine x plus 6x cosine x minus 6 sine x, and then our arbitrary constant at the end. That is our solution. If you can believe that, that handles all the work. That table organized all the work of doing integration by parts three times over before we get to a final answer. That's pretty remarkable. I'm going to clean this up a little bit because I do want to check it by derivation just to dispel any uncertainty that you may have. So let's see, best way to do this would probably be to take my cosine terms, group those together, and let's see what we can't do with some creative factoring techniques here, huh? So if I take an x and a cosine x, it's not going to make it much better, is it? I'll have negative x squared. This isn't going to be very pretty. Negative x squared, plus 6. And then my sine terms, if I do the same thing there, Here I can take out a 3, and I'll be left with x squared sine x. Oh, not sine x anymore. I'll take out the sine x as well. That's why I grouped it. I'll be left with an x squared minus 2. Right, and again, we're hoping to get back to x cubed times sine x at the very end of this. So I'm going to bulldoze through this and see if we can't make this derivative work. All right, so our derivative check, we'll do this work in black. This answer in red should be trustworthy. So if I take the derivative of this, I've got x cosine x for a first piece times this for a second. It's a product rule. So I've got first d second plus second d first, which is another chain rule, first d second plus, oop, d second is negative sine x. That's first d second plus second d first and we've handled that first term, that x cosine x times that quantity. All right, next, plus, here we got another product rule. We've got first d second plus second d first, just a 3 cosine x. And then plus c will derivate down to 0. Okay, lots of terms, lots of terms. I'm just trying to see if at a glance I see an x cubed times sine x emerging there. And I do. When I take this and FOIL it into that. Hopefully everything else cancels. Let's see what we get. Negative 2x squared cosine x plus, and here I'm going to FOIL this out. I've got x cubed sine of x. Outside, I get minus x squared cosine of x. Inside, I get minus 6x sine of x. And last times last, I get plus 6 cosine x. Let's keep going. Now I've got 3 times sine x times 2x. That's plus a 6x sine x. And then I've got some distribution plus x squared, sorry, 3x squared. Cosine x minus 6 cosine x. You can't see it on the video, but I'm really excited about doing this and realize that we had our answer a long time ago. I'm just checking the work here. So let's see, I've got. Oh man. No, I'm good. I've got a negative 2 x squared cosine x. Then I add 3 x squared cosine x to it, combining like terms, and a negative 1 x squared cosine x. Those all cancel each other out. I've got a minus 6 cosine x and a plus 6 cosine x. Those cancel each other out when I combine like terms. A plus 6x sine x and a minus 6x sine x. All that remains is x cubed sine of x. So we've confirmed that this tabular method does work at doing repeated integration by parts. Again, all that work in black at the end was just a check, and I apologize if it got a bit lengthy, but man, really just nerded out right there. That was a lot of fun. All right, so tabular method is what we can do if we notice that just one run through integration by parts isn't working. We have that special setup. Another extension of integration by parts is what I call cyclicals, and that's just my own term. That's not something that I think is accepted math vernacular here. But what if both of the parts that we have in our integral, neither of those will derivate down to 0, so I can't use the tabular method. And if I were to just go straight through integration by parts, Well, then that second integral, that integral v du, that's not going to be something that's any easier than what I started with. What this leads to is what I call, or what I'll refer to as combine like terms at the end. We're just going to have to run through our integration by parts twice. We're going to have to, bear down and do that. But because of the cyclical nature of derivating each piece, it won't take long before we're able to actually solve this all the way out. So this integral that I'm given is what I'm trying to evaluate. Let's do integration by parts. So I'll set up my u and my dv. We'll fill in a box. I hope I left myself enough room. I apologize if this is hard to see on the video if it's too small. But for u, I got e to the x. For dv, I've got sine of 3x dx. For function v, if I backtrack my way through, that would have to be a negative 1/3 cosine of 3x. And to find du, well, that's easy enough. It's e to the x dx. So my initial integral turns into u times v. So let's tuck that negative 1/3 out in front. Negative 1/3 e to the x cosine of 3x. That term's solid. That term is right there. That'll be part of my final answer. Minus the integral of v du. And you can see here, after one run through integration by parts, that integral that I have at the end, it's not any easier than what I started with. I still have two functions. None of them got simpler. Let's see if we can't clean up the work that we've shown. I've got 1/3 e to the x cosine of 3x. I can free this negative 1/3. To clean up that integral a little bit, and you can see, hopefully, you got a little bit of foresight. That looks eerily similar to the integral I started with. I have a feeling that if I'm to take this integral and use integration by parts again, that the cyclical nature of derivating these terms, integrating these pieces, I should say, inside the integral will produce another identical integral to the one I'm trying to find. So, okay, let's let u equal e to the x again. We'll let dv equal cosine 3x this time. Set up a second box. Oh, that's using no foresight whatsoever myself. Maybe like that. U is e to the x. Du will then be e to the x dx. The dv I started with was cosine 3x dx. And then to work my way backwards to regular function v, well, that had to be a 1/3 sine of 3x. All right, so try and keep the colors coordinated here. I've still got that original u times v term. I've still got the plus 1/3, but now what's inside that is going to be u times v, so that will be 1/3 e to the x sine of 3x. Minus the integral v du, 1/3 sine of 3x times e to the x dx. And look at that integrand. That looks so close to what we have. All we need to do is free that 1/3, and we have a like term. Cleaning up now, negative 1/3 e to the x cosine of 3x. Let's distribute this positive 1/3, right? It's distributing into that all that work in blue. So I've got plus 1/9 e to the x sine of 3x. And then that will be minus 1/3 the integral of 1/3 sine of 3x e to the x dx. I can free that 1/3, and instead of writing this whole line again, I'm going to take the easy way out and move that. And remember that this is all equivalent to the integral I started with. Well, take a look at what we've just done. I've got the original integral, and then I see the same integral again. Those are like terms. So what I can do is I can add 1/9 of this integral to both sides. And I'll arrive here at, this will be 10 over 9 times the integral e to the x sine of 3x dx. And that's going to equal negative 1/3 e to the x cosine of 3x plus 1/9 e to the x sine of 3x. So the last thing I need to do to actually solve and finally figure out what this integral is equivalent to is divide away that 10/9. Let's multiply both sides by the reciprocal. So our final answer ends up being 9/10 times 1/3 is going to be negative 3/10 e to the x. Cosine of 3x. And 1/9 of 9/10 is 1/10 e to the x sine of 3x. We finally figured out what that integral is. We got to tack on that arbitrary constant at the end, though. So we arrive at our final answer. Okay, and I'm going to spare you all the derivative work of checking that to make sure it works. I can assure you that it does. That is how we handle cyclicals, and it's kind of a bear. It really is a long process, but as we move through, it kind of makes sense, and it's really interesting when you get to the end of all this complicated work to say, oh, this is just like a really simple Algebra 1 problem where you combine like terms at the end to solve. So that's always kind of a nice little silver lining at the very end. And the last little thing, it's not really an extension, it's just something that I would call neat ones. So we have what appears to be, at a glance, something that we think would belong in part one, where we can simply antiderivate. However, we do not have any derivative rules that we know of that lead us to natural log. So for this first example, I can't just antiderivate because no derivative leads me there. Can't just work my way backwards. So this is an extension of parts. I'm going to think of this as natural log x times 1. So as I break this down, natural log will be u, because it has to be. That's, I can only derivate it. I can't antiderivate natural log. And then this 1 dx will be dv. So if I set up a box for this one, I'm not sure if I can fit both of these on the same screen. So I apologize if it's... So we'll set that up. Our dv was 1 dx, meaning that v had to be x. And we'll arrive at an antiderivative for natural log, which is pretty cool when you think about it, because that's not a rule that we learn. All right, so this integral is going to equal u times v minus the integral of v du. Oh, and look at this. Natural log x times x minus the integral of 1 dx. I can anti-differentiate that. Apologize for bumping the mic there. I get x natural log x minus x, and then our arbitrary constant. So that function, if I derivate it, and I encourage you to check that out, that will lead me back to natural log x if I do derivate it. So that's just kind of a neat thing, some derivative rule that we never learned. I mean, what's the point in learning this as a derivative rule that derivates to natural log? Are we ever likely to see that and need to derivate it? Probably not. If we do, we're seeing something special. But again, really cool use of parts to kind of answer a question that we haven't really been able to answer yet. Let's try the same thing with inverse sine. It's going to be the same thing where I think of that inverse sine as multiplied by 1. So I can see there are two parts in there, even though one of them is just a 1. I have to let sine inverse be u. I don't know how to anti-differentiate that, so I couldn't call that dv. Well, du here, 1 over square root of 1 minus x squared dx. If our dv is 1 dx, then our v had to have been just an x. Let's see what we come up with here. So that integral is going to be u times dv minus the integral of v du. Okay, this one looks pretty intimidating, right? Let me clean up that first term a bit. And although this integral that I'm left with looks pretty nasty, if you think back to the second type, this is a u substitution problem. So to handle this integral right here, I'm going to let u equal 1 minus x squared, then du would equal negative 2x. So I would need to multiply in a negative 2. That means multiplying a negative 1 half outside to get that u du relationship. So I'm just going to do this work off to the side in green. So I will have negative 1 half times the integral of 1 over root u. You know what? I'm going to call that u to the negative 1 half. And I have everything in place for my du. That's negative 1 half times, to anti-differentiate this, it had to start off as a u to the positive 1 half. So 2u to the positive 1 half will do the derivation that I need. So that's negative u to the 1 half. That's negative square root of 1 minus x squared. All right, so let's go back to our work in blue. Then I'm subtracting away the negative square root of 1 minus x squared. Now, again, this is something that you're never going to be given that function there that we just arrived at and then asked to derivate it. There's no sense in learning a rule to do all that. I'm just going to confirm my work here and make sure that that derivative is in fact correct. Oh, I'm an idiot. That's all. it turns out when I, right here, I should say, here, let's get the black marker out for that. This is supposed to be u times v. I did u times du. So that should just be an x. As should this, as should this. So actually the final answer, I apologize for this mistake. That's embarrassing. I get x sine inverse of x plus square root of 1 minus x squared plus c. That's the correct end result there. And it was just a simple, I referred to the box wrong, so it was a simple substitution error on my part. But I hope that makes sense, that we can still use this parts, even if there's no second part given. We can use a 1 to integrate something that we didn't think could be antiderivated, we didn't think could be integrated. I hope this little lesson, I say little, but it ended up being 45 minutes long. I hope this has been a neat little exploration for you to go through the different integration techniques that we had, that we have at our disposal, and when to use each one, what things to look for, things of that sort. If anything, maybe we just were entertained by a couple extra examples. Again, I hope that was beneficial. There's one method of integration that we did not cover here that we will in class, and that is integration by partial fraction decomposition. And that's something that is so recognizable when we see it that I feel like this video doesn't necessarily merit anything with that. All of these, when you see the integral, they can kind of look similar. So that's why it's important to learn the different techniques and how to recognize which ones to use. Again, I hope you found this useful, and thanks for spending 45 minutes with me. Happy integrating, everybody.